the great pleasure of meeting Keith a couple years ago when we were summer residents at Archie Bray, and I think that his extrusion printer was in fact the first one that I'd seen. So that was a very memorable experience for me. So I'm going to hand it over to Keith to wow you with this demonstration. Thank you all so much for coming.
Sorry for the delay. Is this mic on? Is that working okay? Like, that's just for the web. That's not for you guys. Can you hear me? Okay. So I guess I have an hour and a half, a little less than that now, but what we'll try to do is I'll kind of show you what I'm doing with this machine, and then we'll take a little break, and we'll come back and do a little presentation, and I'll do some slides and show you how I got to where I am, and maybe we can talk a little bit about like what I might do next, and try not to make it I all about me. I'm trying to share things as openly as possible, but I'm really thinking about this machine for me as a open experimental digital platform where I'm trying to develop tools that I can use in my studio and try to help get some young guys, young students excited about bringing these tools in their studio and sharing everything as much as I can so that we can, they can show us what we should really be doing with it. So I've been wrestling my way through this piece of equipment for, I guess, since 2014. And really, for me, it was an issue of access where there were these tools at schools that I could use, but I could only use them in really traditional ways, and it was kind of hard to get access. So I wanted my own tool so I could really learn it and get in there, twist the bolts and stuff, and make it do what I wanted to do. So first of all, this is a machine. It's like a CNC. It was a CNC, and I just put legs on it. That's essentially all it is. It's a kit machine. We can talk more about that in the presentation. But there's a print apparatus here. This motor turns, and it squeezes this little rubber tube. And when the motor does one full revolution, it puts one little droplet of this slip out. So I'll just kind of set up. If you have any kind of questions as I'm going here, I'm going to assemble this pump. I had it apart so you could see what the inside looks like. And I'll try to see if we can show you the workflow from Rhino as well as kind of a little bit about the machine. So I guess Kelly's presentation was really fantastic, where they're talking about the students using the digital tools to make prototypes for other production methods like slip casting and ram pressing and things like that. And I'm really thinking about this as a potential mode of production. So where you design an object differently for ram pressing or for 3D printing or for ram pressing or slip casting or any of those operations, I'm designing objects differently for this particular mode of production. It's a lot of hex keys with this machine. Feel free to kind of come and go and ask questions when I'm quiet.
I have one. Is it on a three axis?
Yeah, it's X, Y, and Z. Okay. Yeah. And I went this way because I can take this tool head off and put a router on there, a small router, like a trim router, and take the legs off of it, and I can do milling with it too in the studio. So the first thing I have is the slip. So this is a bucket of slip, and I'll tell you guys more about the slip recipes that I'm using. They're a little bit different. So this is the viscosity of it. I guess I can kind of show you as it's mixed. I mixed this yesterday, and it's kind of like a glaze, right? So it's akin to a clay recipe, though. It has the fired characteristics of a clay recipe. It is chemically in composition the same as like a porcelain recipe, but the difference is that it's been reformulated to have very little clay because I want a low viscosity for going through this pump, and I don't want it to shrink as much. Like if you had a clay body that has at least 50% clay, it's going to shrink a lot. It's going to hold on to that water for a while, but I want the layers as this thing builds up to dry. So I'm going to put a little bit of magnesium sulfate solution in there to thicken it, and we'll see what that does to the viscosity. So you'll do this in the glaze lab because your glazes can settle sometimes. But this should bring it up to, I'll show you the viscosity again in a minute. But I'm looking for something kind of like a homemade ricotta cheese. Not like the ricotta you get at the store that's really thick, but like when it's homemade, well, at least when I make it, it's a little bit runnier. It's also a really fun thing to make in the kitchen. It's super easy. Viscosity in the what? Yeah, there's a limit to how thick I can get it, but the thicker it is, the better it is. You're creating a mixture that is like on the threshold of like a threshold of kind of dilatancy, so that the second it dismisses a little bit of water, it has goes through kind of a rheological change, like the viscosity of the slip. As soon as it dismisses a little bit of water, it kind of starts behaving more like a solid. It's like I don't know. I've never done it. I didn't grow up on the coast, but people build like those sand drip castles. So that's a good analogy of what it is really. So it's magnesium sulfate. Most people know it as Epsom salt. So you can get it at the, you can get it from Laguna, like on your clay shipment in a 50-pound bag, or you can get it from Walgreens. It's good for baths, I guess. I don't know what it's supposed to do in a bath. Yeah, so it's a saturated solution. So I have my core container with magnesium sulfate. And then I know that as long as there's some crystals at the bottom, the water has as much as it can possibly hold. And my solution will always be the same, right? So if you didn't have that stuff at the bottom, it wouldn't be necessarily a saturated solution. So there's a nice visual cue for that. I'll talk about that a lot more later, but no, I've tried a lot of things. And the things that you might be thinking of, like Darvan or sodium silicate dispersants and stuff, they act on surface area. So if you and clay is the smallest particle generally that's in your regular typical bodies. So that's the viscosity now. You could make a sculpture with that too. There's a great idea right there. All right, I got it all over me already. So at home, I've set up so that I have a reservoir off to the side. I'm using gravity and a small amount of air pressure to run it through a hose to get to the machine, but I didn't travel with that, so I just got this little reservoir sitting here. It's really cool because it can run for a whole day now without being supervised. And it usually works. It works often enough that it's worth it. There. And I just kind of have this lid so that the top of this slip doesn't dry.
What is the dry time within that slip?
It varies with humidity. Sometimes when I'm printing, I was printing at the Archie Bray last summer. And everything was going great until a cloudburst happened. And then all of a sudden, the slip wasn't drying as fast because the air is really wet. So it can change. I'll use fans in the studio sometimes to control that. Once it's thickened, it basically stays there. I do notice that it changes over a period of days. If anyone thickens their glazes with magnesium sulfate, I don't know what's happening exactly, but you'll see it kind of, it can change over. The immediate effect doesn't necessarily imply what the long-term effect of that addition is. So can we get the computer up on the screen here? This is Rhino. I'm using a student edition. It costs $300. I do try to like limit the hurdles in my process. I'm not really. I'm not really thrilled that I have to use something that costs money because it creates this hurdle, but it's not a huge one, and it has some stuff that I really need. So what I'm going to print today are some cups that are like these with a 3D printed kind of profile that's using our drawing tool in Rhino. And I have some files prepped, but I'll show you basically what I'm doing with Rhino to make these forms. So I'm just using this basic drawing tool, which is this line tool. And I'm just stroking around and making a shape. That looks like a fine cup for me. That's great. So it's really loose. I can do it. And like Jerry Salt said last night, 85% of art's garbage. So I really only need 15% of these to work out, you know? And I do. I kind of just I like this flexible process for these parallel walled things. I like the kind of the feistiness of making something that's kind of hard to drink out of, and we're just at the beginning of these digital tools, so it's kind of great to make the kind of easiest thing to make. Like we're talking about designing an object that is for a specific mode of production. This happens to be this printer. So I would just make a series of shapes like that. And I would fill up this whole bay, so I could print maybe 15 or 20 of them. I have a separate file prep, so I'm not going to spend too much time with this. I'll show you just my workflow. So I can use just scale, and I usually like I'll scale stuff until it's about cup size. This I've set up my file, so it happens to actually be the same size as the build platform here, so I could fill this whole thing and populate it with stuff. Maybe in this case, I'm going to actually print cup size stuff, but maybe I'll just do this as though I'm printing like bigger stuff. So this would fit on the machine. And you can imagine how big it is a little bit by, this is the size of the build platform. So this is, I guess this is 24 by 24, but really it's 500 millimeters. I'm working in millimeters. So you just use a few tools, rotate, scale, and that drawing tool. I have to spell it right. And I really like the text interface that happens with Rhino. It's like my favorite thing about it, because I don't really, you don't have to remember where everything's located necessarily. And you can do a lot of damage with just a few of the tools in Rhino or any 3D drawing program. You don't necessarily need to know the whole program inside and out to start making stuff. I'm going to flip that. I'm not using separate layers, no. This is a mirror tool, so I can make that, I can mirror it into a spot that it, then I'll delete that. So this will be good enough to illustrate what I'm going to try to do with Grasshopper, which is the reason that I use Rhino. Any of these basic drawing tools you could get in any program, and a lot of the free ones are really great. But Grasshopper is going to be the way that I generate my code to run the machine. And I like it because I can really control what the mark of the machine is. So Grasshopper can be pulled up just the same way. I have to spell it right again. Okay. And we're going to use, first I'm going to use this offset curves function. So this is a this is not a great example of what you do in Rhino, what you do in Grasshopper, and I can't explain this very well. This is just a shortcut tool that was actually curated for me. Someone made this for me, a guy named Joe Kim. He's awesome. So what this does is Rhino has a problem with offsetting curves to make the path. So what I want is a series of circles, smaller ones inside of this until you can imagine if the tool was following each of those paths, it would construct the entire floor. So you could do that manually by simply clicking the curve that you're interested in and hitting offset, telling it the distance that you want to go. I want to go 3 millimeters. And then I would move that inside, and I could grab this one, pull up that tool again, and just keep doing that. So you don't need to know Grasshopper to do that. You could manually draw it. But I think if this works, which sometimes it doesn't, but Basically, this window here is Grasshopper functioning along line and inside Rhino. And what it allows you to do is do some simple programming and using visual nodes. I'm not by any means an expert in it, but I know that you can just get tutorials online. It's free and open, and you just get busy with it, and you'll figure it out. But so if I want to do, I'll explain more with the next code, I think. Simply, I'm going to set these in, set multiple curves. And I will take a second to explain that more with the next one. And then this function that comes out, bake, and I should get a series of curves that fill up that whole space. So that's just a shortcut that was built for my particular workflow. Not necessary, but pretty cool. I also find that these little pads in the middle, I don't like them. They're too much. There's like, you will see when we print it that it actually becomes full in because the slip kind of overflows into that spot. Okay, so those are the pads that would build the floor of these pots. I actually need to get rid of the original curves. There's a duplicate of that curve on the outside because it kept the input curves. All right, and then my workflow to make to actually build the floor of the pot, I'm going to open this offset curves printing with Z2. So this is something that I constructed, and it looks like just a tangled mess of wires. I usually zoom in here, and what I've done is I've put the input and the output here. So these are the things I really need to have. If it was for use for everyone, you know, you could make it really nice, put it in a little box, you could hide all those other wires. But this is really just something that I use. But you can imagine if I input some curves here, it goes here, and this first node is going to sort the ones that are open or closed. So this is a good place to start because that's a good illustration of like what this does. Each node provides some sort of function that sorts these toolpaths to make the thing that I want to make. So the first thing is that there's two different kinds of curves, a curve that comes all the way around and closes off, and then there's a curve that that doesn't come around. So it's just a C. It's like an O versus a C. And to generate the paths from those, I'm taking a curve. I'm selecting a series of points on that curve using a different node. And I want to, on a closed curve, I want to give it a series of points. And then I want it to go back to that first point again. So it closes that C off into an O, right? But if I want to just do a curve and start at one spot and end, so that's a good illustration of what each of these individual nodes do. And it's a really great way to think about programming for people who are visually minded. And most artists, I tend to believe, are. All right, so this is going to generate some tool paths. And I'll just go into Rhino window, and I'm going to select them all. And then I'll go here. This is where I input my geometry. I'm going to set multiple geometries. And it's thinking. Okay, so it selected all those points. We can see in the Rhino window that the curves that I fed in, all these little X's are grasshopper objects, the red ones. So those don't really exist in Rhino, but those indicate the points that I'm using to make the toolpaths for this machine. So each of those X's has an X and a Y coordinate, and the machine can find that if I give it to it. And if I give it them in the right sequence and tell it to squirt slip, it will build that floor. So I actually go in here, and I'm just going to copy the data out of here. And then I use actually Notepad a lot, which I'm going to get better at Rhino, and I'm going to do more with Grasshopper. And it'd be really great if it did all the formatting for me. But I don't mind hacking it together a little bit, too. So I have this G-code header, which is just a text file. And that's what it looks like. So you see at the very top, it says G90. That tells the machine to work in the global mode so that everything has an XY point. There's another mode that's G91. This is standard G-code for any CNC, and most 3D printers use it. And there's G91 would move, every time I told it to move 10 millimeters in the X, it would move 10 millimeters in the X. But if I'm feeding it this code that tells it to go to 10 in the G90, the global mode, it's going to go to that point. If I tell it to go to that point again, it won't move. because it's already there. And right here, this is the feed rate that tells it how fast to go. And normally on the floors, I'd go a little faster than that. G94, actually, I forgot what that is. I don't know. I don't think it's important. I hope it's not. So G92 is a way of attributing a value. So I can tell it that A is 0. So I have X, Y, and Z coordinates. And then I have another axis, a fourth motor. It's the A. And that's what actually runs. And I'm going to put my G code here in that little parentheses area. Anything that's parentheses off like that, the machine will ignore. So I'll just paste that in there. And now I'm going to go ahead and kind of show you some sending some code to the machine and setting that up. And I'm just going to get rid of this because I don't need it. I have a code already that's a little bit akin to the one that's there. So setting up this machine, I'm going to print on plaster. I've never done it before. I'm kind of winging this. It'll be fine. So I got this set at 0 and this set at 0. And then I kind of know how high I want this platform to be. I want it to be 2 inches tall. And I'll just level with the ruler and 3 wedges. I really like this part of it because I like working with my hands. We talk about 3D printing stuff, and people will say, oh, you just press print? Yeah, you can do that. Or you can wrestle and fight it and pull your hair out like I do. Oh, I also need to set the Z axis here. So I want that higher. Do we want to get, something here? So this is the program that I'm going to use to send code to my tiny G here. Connect. And this will let me do stuff. First thing I need to do is get this nozzle at the right place. So I'm going to go G91. I'm going to do that twice, and then I'll verify that you'll see there where it says the distance mode, it says G91. And I'm going to move that up. So I'm going to G0, Z. I'm going to go a real big jump of 1 millimeter. So it just moved 1 millimeter up. And I really want to just get this nozzle at the right height. And then I'll powder the bed, and we should be able to just get it running. So I like it. It's funny that like everything's in metric, and then I'm using a standard ruler. But I like it. It's divided in tenths. I like it at a quarter of an inch to 0.3. And then I'm going to go ahead and G92, Z0. So what that's going to do is I told it to go to a different position. And then if I query it again, that G92 command told it, that new position that I told it to go to is the 0. So something got kind of out of alignment in the shipping, and you're going to hear it in a minute, so don't be scared. And I'm going to tell it to, I'm just going to tell it to lift the Z up to 200 millimeters, and it magically repaired itself overnight. Okay, so this container is full of powdered malachite. There's a number of powdered materials that you could use from the glaze lab to kind of keep it from sticking to the bed and allowing it to shrink and move a little bit. I like this because it's really low in crystalline silica, and most of us know that that's not great for us at all. I would use a respirator normally, but I'm gonna wing this and keep my head away from it. And I'll powder the whole bed. And I'm gonna put a lot of powder. This might take a minute. Does anyone have questions that I can field with my back to you?
It
really depends. I have some pieces over in the Tactic exhibition, and I really am trying to figure out a workflow so that I can design something and print it really fast so that I don't have to get to attach the code and keep printing the same thing over and over again. I want a flexible process. And there's opportunities with Grasshopper to use that flexible process and kind of process forms and generate forms so that everyone has like a unique
characteristic. That's what I'm interested in. But, you know, it took me 20 minutes in the hotel this morning to make the code that I'm going to run today. Well, the presentation will kind of go into that. One thing is that I was just kind of curious about what else we could do if we thought about different formulations for clays. And some of it is just paying attention to what happens in the studio. I started by making, I didn't think it'd be as easy to print as it was, so I started by thinking about being able to draw lines of glaze with this pump. And when I saw that glaze building up, something kind of clicked about potential formulations of clay bodies that were more akin to glaze recipes. This thing's real plugged. If anyone has a better idea about how to spread this powder, I'm open to it. Everything's in development all the time. It's like, and I'm building a second machine now so that one of the machines could maybe do some production and keep doing the same thing, while the second machine could really be a research tool, see what else could be done. Yeah. A little bit. The resolution that I'm willing to suffer through this tool is pretty high. This is doesn't really compare to the resolution of a traditional 3D printer, right? So I'm going to find out where I'm at again, and I'm going to go. I'm still in incremental mode, which is important because if I was in the global mode, the G90 in the distance mode there, if I told it to go -200. It would actually continue downward until it, I didn't give it the coordinate, G-O-Z, -200. It would continue past that previously established, that's that noise I was telling you about. But if I was in that other mode, it would keep going 200 millimeters into the negative, and it would actually tear itself apart. So I'm glad we didn't do that. Still in incremental. GOA 1. So I'm moving to a different axis. So I have X, Y, and Z axes for movement, and the A axis is the extruder. And I'm just going to go 1 millimeter at a time until some slip comes out. And nothing is, there it is. I was worried for a second there. That's enough. Yeah, let's go back to the machine. So I just need to make sure that everything's at zero, and I just fed a bunch of stuff to A, so I need to set A back to zero. And everything's cool, I think. I'm gonna clear that data and just verify that again. And so I need to go to the G90 mode, verify that. So I'm back in this absolute distance mode. This is the incremental. So I'm going to clear that data, connection, send text file. And I'm going to send a file that I generated this morning. It's on the desktop. And it says in Cica Floor. And it should just start running. It's not running real great yet. I think the Z might be the slightest bit high. It's a collaborative. Two point. We're going to let it be what it is. It's a little looser. I would normally kind of restart it. And I think that I maybe thickened the slip a little bit more than I'd like to. Only when you're in front of a bunch of people, live broadcasting. Should be okay. Yeah, I think I need to make some adjustments to the viscosity of the slip. I'm going to go ahead and let this run and see what happens while I adjust my other bucket of slip and think about restarting it. So that just press print thing. The feed rate's controlled by the Grasshopper code that I generated. And it's not an auger. It's a peristaltic pump, so it squeezes a little rubber tube. It just squeezes a little rubber tube. It works like the human intestines, or any mammals, really. Well. There's only one way to find out.
What was that clear thing you added?
So that's magnesium sulfate solution, Epsom salt solution. And I'm just going to try to empty it and start it up again. And how much time do we have till 11?
9 minutes.
9 minutes? Okay, that's the game. We're going to try to do it by nine. No, there's a lot more control in the studio. Like, I mix a bigger slip bucket. I have a nicer mixer. What's that? I do have, like, a pressurized feed. But it's actually not more than the feed that's happening now. It's just akin to, it's making that, it's like gravity with a much larger reservoir, the hydraulic pressure. Yeah, I trust myself, obviously, a little bit more than I should today. Does someone want to help put some powder on another board? Can I have an intern? Great. Yeah, so you just kind of will put some of this malachite in here and just kind of tap like this and try to coat the whole thing. It usually takes a couple passes.
Okay.
Take a break when your hands get tired. Where am I at here? Yeah, it helps it keep from sticking so it can move as it shrinks a little bit. There's a free painting over here if anyone wants it. You can hang it up in your house. All right, so we need to get that reservoir off there. Yeah. No, I mean, since I'm hacking my way through it with kind of the skill level that I've developed doing this, there's like some hiccups, like I can't pause. Like if it fails, it fails. But really, it works 90% of the time, which is pretty good. Like if you can, this is what I like to do, is if I can walk in there, like so my studio is at Alfred. I have a little office studio where I can run this machine. And I'm a technician, you know, so I have a 9-to-5 job out there making everyone's dreams come true. And if I can get a good cup of coffee, get in the studio at 7 and set this machine up to run, and then walk back in there at 5 o'clock at the end of the day and some of my dreams came true, that's pretty cool. What's that? You know, in the studio too, I have a sink, which is really convenient. Sure. It might not, but if there's enough, it definitely won't crack. If they really have that space to move. Yeah, it's basically the same design. It's going to start its life out as a CNC. I'm going to do a little project, so it's able to mill a 2-foot by 5-foot, which is pretty cool. And then I really want it to, it's going to have two separate, this is the gantry, and it's going to have two of those, one on each end of the machine, and the thought is that one can come in from one end and put some glaze down, and the other one can come through the other end and put some clay down, and just iterate back and forth that way. I'm gonna make some fine art pieces, and I think we shouldn't be shameful about thinking about production, you know? So I'm trying to figure out how to do both of those things, like have some space where it's really experimental and I can just see what I can do. Like what if I can print an object out of glaze and then dip it in a slip and just invert that whole process of like clay and glaze, surface and substrate. And I'll probably start doing that relatively soon. Like a cooking show. Doesn't taste as good though. So this slip's a lot thinner. I feel more confident that it's going to print pump really well, but it might not have the bones to hold itself up once it gets very tall. So we'll just see. It's wet here in Portland, you know. But we're all temperature and humidity controlled in here. How are we doing on time? Is it 11 yet?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Ooh. It's fine. Can't stress that. I mean, I keep a pretty clean studio. Just kind of clean it up, and when you really have to, suit up and blow it down. And okay. We'll see where we're at here, and I'll just try to pump some clay.
Do you want me to pour some more?
That's probably fine. All right. Thanks. So the A, G, thanks a lot.
No problem.
That's primed and it's pumping a lot better. Yeah, there's a small, especially when you're running with a thicker slip, the thicker the slip is, the more potential you trap a little bubble of air. Gonna make that noise, screaming in pain. Well, that's a lot better. I think at this point we'll let that run and then I'll switch to another computer. I'll show you guys some stuff on Photoshop, on PowerPoint, of kind of how I got to this point. And then I'll come back and I'll feed it some code when it finishes the floor that'll start the walls. Does the next presentation start at 11? Time for the next presentation? Okay, there's a break. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, the motors make some sound. I don't know exactly what's going on. It has it's been printing so much better, but you ship a piece of equipment, take it apart in a crate, and ship it across the country. Some things get out of alignment.
Do it always have that noise?
Yeah, the noise is inherent to the speed and direction of the stepper motors. Yeah. There's no router, right? Yeah. There's enough people doing that, you know what I mean? Like, and I can't really wrestle with the big dogs when it comes to financing that kind of equipment, you know? So I'm fine with the lower resolution. I would actually get looser, but I'd mean a larger machine probably. So since the recipe is inherently non-plastic, has very little clay in it, there's not really much time to handling it. You just need to kind of get it in the kiln. It's like a glaze recipe, so it has about 15% clay and the rest is non-plastics. And I hope you'll look closer at the piece here because it does work relatively well. Some things happen differently. So I have a really nice mixer and I let it run for a long time. And this stuff, since I had to travel, I didn't take the water. You know, I didn't mix it beforehand. I brought the powder and mixed it with a drill. I was confident that was going to work, but it does look like it really did make a difference with the slip, like the time and the mixing it. Okay, can we get the PowerPoint up there? So this is an algorithmic poem that was written by some people. I think 85 is the when this book came out. The policeman's beard is half constructed. And so I've actually labeled all my files for my testing that I'm doing Ractor. I just really love this. So these engineers, they gave the program a series of fragments that it could work with and move around. And then there's this editing involved to really make it into a poem. So that's one thing that's really interesting right off the bat is that the machine can do a lot of things and it can do exactly, but it can only do exactly what I can tell it to do. And it also can't edit. It can't say this one's good and this one's not good, you know? So there's a lot of involvement for the maker still in this process. I titled my presentation An 8-Hour Build because that's what I was working towards at the point. I was working towards having this machine operate for a full 8 hours unattended so that I could really have a functional studio practice while I was doing other things and kind of see what that looked like and try it on for size. So why digital tools? For me, it's one part of my studio practice. I make molds and I slip class and I love to sculpt and hand build. But how cool would it be if I'm in the studio for the day, I have this running on one side of the studio and I'm freed up to do those other things, and how those things kind of fit together is really interesting to me. Also, I came out of a 3D printing industry. I worked for 3 years as a mold maker for a rapid prototyping company before I went to my undergrad. So these tools that were on the market since maybe 1985 that the rapid prototyping companies that are using, $1 million laser, it's an SLA apparatus is the really common one that those guys use, really high resolution. So we would take those parts off the machine and I would spend days sanding them and mimicking the finishes, making molds and then casting them in materials that would simulate the physical properties of the end product. And it's usually like things like lots of bezels, housings for things, keyboards, the casings for computers and things like that. But they really wanted a product that they could photograph that would really look like the real thing so they could sell it. And for me, it's like it is a natural continuation of my kind of experimental studio practice. Whether I'm on the wheel or I'm slip casting, it's all a curiosity and just kind of, I love it. Developing understanding and methodologies towards teaching and thinking expansively about potential digital practices. So just like we have this traditional kind of thinking of ceramics sometimes, that is, you throw the piece, you bisque the piece, you glaze the piece, there's all sorts of ways to mix that operation around. And there's so much of that happening here, too. Like, I know everyone's doing it. I'm just so excited about it. So I'm interested in engaging conversations about craft beyond hands. So we sometimes we talk about craft, and I've had images of this stuff posted online and kind of be brutalized and attacked. Like phrases like, I don't know what this is. It's cool, but it's not art. Like, I don't know what that is. But I think we need to start this dialogue, and it's happening here a lot. But out in the world, that like craft is not just fingertips and clay. So it's an educational process, too. I'm developing understanding of tools. I'm developing tools that'll do something for my studio practice. And I'm developing materials that'll work for my studio practice. And the end goal is always to express something. And then to teach and share so that we can kind of move this thing forward and see what the potential really is. I don't think I'm going to be the potential, but if I can spark that in someone else and get some stuff triggered and people thinking about these things in new ways that I can't imagine is what we really want to see. So that all has to do with access for me. I started to develop my own tool because I had questions in my practice about how to access this equipment and how to use it. Sometimes it's under kind of lock and key at universities, and it's hard to get to. And I also kind of wanted a machine that I could figure out how everything moved around, and it was strong enough to do some reductive CNC work. It was strong enough to do some additive work, and not so strong that it could kill me. Like, some of these machines are really dangerous. So I started with this kit. This is the Shapeoko. They don't make this machine anymore, but all the stuff's online for free. So you can download the files and you can source out, you could laser cut the parts from plastic. A lot of the components come from two companies, Open Builds and Inventables. Shapeoko has gone through several iterations, and now it's a complete separate CNC machine, which isn't going to do what I want it to do, because it comes with a controller that can only do 3 axes, and I really need 4. So this is the machine as I got it. So it came in and it had a workspace of something in the neighborhood of 6 or 8 inches in each direction. It's really small, and I knew I was going to do some reductive work, but I also wanted to do some additive stuff, and I knew I was going to need more vertical space, so I increased the z-axis, and it was a simple operation, relatively inexpensive. And that's about 2014. This is the controller board that I'm using. It's the brain of the machine. So the machine itself is just some plates, four or five motors, and some belts. You need something that's going to communicate with the data that you're sending to it and turn that into motion. That's what the controller does. And there's lots of ways to do that with Arduino systems, and there's other controllers on the market. This is one that was kind of around at the time, 2014, when I was starting, and it seemed to do what I wanted to do, and it has the built-in four motor control, and it interprets the code from four separate motors. So I didn't know if I was going to do additive stuff. I was curious about it, and I wanted that possibility, so I just left that doorway open with this controller. The drawing on the right is this laser cut case. And that's kind of one of the things too. I've been functioning within. I was at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn when I first started this, and the first thing I did is kind of use the digital tools that they have to kind of build what I need in my own studio. So the cable chain, the management system on this for the cables, is all 3D printed, and then this housing here for the tiny G. I'll share that with anyone if they want it, just email it. It's just one little hurdle. You could put it in a cardboard box and it would still work, but this looks a little bit better. This is the very first code that I generated, and this is kind of interesting because when I was first learning about computers, maybe in middle school or even elementary school late, we had, I think it was an Apple IIe program where it had this little triangle turtle thing, and you give it code to move around and make lines and make mazes and stuff. So I was kind of, I'd seen that and was aware of it. So I knew you could write the code for these things by hand, and this is the first code that I wrote for the machine. This should be a short video. So this is just some hand-drawn code. So you could do some drawings by hand almost right away, just plugging it in, and you could do that. And so I'm still generating code by hand. I don't know how to use camming software, and everything that I found that seemed user-friendly, it costs some money. I did find a really great one for $300 called MeshCam, which is really cool. So this is some early milling of clay. So this is this machine with, I have my sound off. I want you guys to hear that if I can. There is sound, but yeah, it's up. I guess I wanted to illustrate that this trim router is a really cool option for CNCing, but the problem with it is, the great thing is that it's $60 and it burns out, it's just another $60, it'll keep going. The bad thing is it's really loud, so people use spindle motors now, and you can get one of those for about $400. And if I was going to do reductive milling, or if I was looking at equipment for your school, and you think you want to get a CNC mill, you want a spindle motor. You don't want a router. It's so loud. What's that? So this is leather hard. I have a picture and a recipe for what I'm using there. So this is a recipe that Richard Notkin gave me, and he fires it to cone 6. I didn't put that up there. It's like a Yixing stoneware. It's really simple, 60% red art, 40% OM4. And this is, I haven't done much milling. There's other people who've done a lot more milling of clay, but the first observation is that the spindle or the router blows air on the piece while it's running, and the piece is actively drying and changing shape as it's being cut. You could work with that artistically, but one thought about that is that you could add a little tiny bit of glycerin to that clay to retard that drying so that it could make it through that process. And if I did any more milling, I would play with that. So this is handwritten code. I spent 2 days writing this code by hand, line by line, go to this point, go to this point, go to this point, and I milled both sides of this soap dish that's big enough to hold a bar from a hotel. Like, that's about it. But it's not really about this hotel soap dish. It's about learning the process so that I could figure out what I was going to do next. And just stuff just started to click. So before I go on to additive processes, this is a more recent image, but this is this apparatus with a needle tool in it, just cutting out some shapes, and I'll show you a little time lapse. So, I mean, I guess maybe the first question is, couldn't you just do that by hand? Yeah, but there's some sort of meaning to using the tools that are like the digital drawing tools, that little lasso that's in Rhino, and the kind of shapes that are intrinsic to that kind of landscape, and moving them from this virtual space into the real space is just really fantastic opportunities. So additive processes, I really want to share this. I didn't want to use air pressure. I wanted an open hopper. It's working terribly today. It usually works great. I'll try to get it running really good tomorrow. So I started with this peristaltic pump, and it came from, I wrote it down here somewhere. It's like an American scientific surplus. You might have seen this little 5x8 paper catalog, and all the images are hand-drawn for all the things, and the descriptions are often quite wrong. This described it as a part of a peristaltic pump, and it had a stepper motor connected to it, and it was $6. So I thought, if nothing else, I could use that stepper motor. So I bought it off eBay, but it came from that company. I haven't been able to find any more of them. So what I've done is I've built my own kind of version of that. Right now, the apparatus that's on the machine, I used that object and kind of reverse engineered it and changed some stuff so that it was better for me. And I've been running with that for about 6 months now. Once I get those files really dialed in, I might even share that. I'm a little too worried that the signature of the pump is too exactly, it's going to portion out exactly what I'm doing. So I may share that pump. Okay, so this is a video of the viscosity of the very first print that I did, and I made some terracotta tiles, and I just wanted to put some glaze on a tile. I thought, I can do that, no problem. So that's the viscosity of the glaze. I used MJ's Maiolica, who was the first recipe that I pumped through here. It's from the Val Cushing Handbook. And then the first thing that kind of I noticed was like, wow, that's really thick. That has dimensionality to it. And I really love these lines that drawing with that little tool in Rhino. And so I changed the feed rate and ran another bead on there, and like, wow, that's really building up fast. So I noticed something right away about the formulation with the material. And what I noticed is the glaze dries really quickly compared to clay. And it's become structural really quick. So I was at my home studio. And this is actually the next thing. This is that same print. I didn't even stop. I didn't even fire it. I was like, I'm going to put every bit of glaze I have in my studio through this thing and see what I get. I'm lucky I didn't have much more. But it's like 3D printing, right? So I kept going, and I ended up with this crazy thing. A few different colors of glaze and some different kinds of paths. Like, I could have fired it. I probably will make some work like this. But it just clicked right away, and it was simple. And I just want to, if I can do anything while I'm here is try to remove some of these kind of hurdles that are between people who are interested in working this way. So my initial observations were that glaze slurries build up quickly, and they don't shrink excessively in drying compared to clay bodies. So what's the difference between a glaze recipe? And normally, there's not more than 15% clay. And it's mainly comprised of non-plastic particles, so things that are ground rocks. The first material that I tested, I substituted all but 15% of kaolin in a porcelain recipe that was calcined with calcined kaolin. So I used the product called Glomax, which is low calcined kaolin. And I replaced most of that in the recipe. And I just accounted for the change in weight, because when you calcine a material, the water weight is driven off. So you don't need, you actually need more of the calcined material to replace. And I just got that LOI offline, off the product data sheet. So I'd use only enough water that it could be thoroughly mixed. And what I noticed right away is that I needed more water to mix it, and then it would reduce viscosity overnight, and then I'd thicken with magnesium sulfate, Epsom salt. And these are those first prints. This GoPro that I stumbled into, I was lucky enough that someone just gave me one. But you can see things happening. You see how it dries and it lifts. As it's drying, it lifts and moves. So you can see the shrinkage and what's really happening. It's a really valuable studio tool. So I was not, I was generating this code almost, I was generating 2D G code from Rhino, and I wasn't navigating the Z axis with these prints. So all I would do is I would run it for 10 paths on a particular shape, and then I would change the shape and run it 10. And I didn't have a vision of what that finished object was. And they never really became finished objects, but they were these kind of unique little, they're almost little love letters to George Timock, like his little sculptures, like sacred vessels. I think this might be, that's just a picture of it, okay. So here's another time lapse. I'm not sure exactly what this is. So these are some bowls, and I just love this because you really see it moving as it's drying. So that's a really important observation. As I started to struggle with, like, or learn more about other slip formulations. And I thought you guys might like to see my cat. But these are some forms that came out of those, just playing with just 2D, just navigating the X and Y to generate a 3D object without a vision of what it was, but just a trust that there was some potential there. And then this is the machine running. This is really, it runs like this all the time, like a dream, except for today. But these are some cups that I started to play with. And like I said, I have a kind of a diverse studio practice, and I think a lot of us do, but often there's just kind of one thing that we put out into the world. So I'm sculpting and making things by hand on one side of the studio, and I like that. And while I'm sitting here watching this thing, hypnotized by that piece, I gotta do something. So I pinch these little handles out, and then that pink glue. It's PC11 from the hardware with just a little bit of pigment in it that I got from Smooth-On. It's really simple. It's, you know, glue is this kind of secret to making ceramics these days, it seems like, but we're always trying to hide it. And I don't think there's a big statement there, but maybe there's a permission, you know, to do that. And some of these contoured forms, the first reason that I kind of thought that, oh, I can do something like with those is I thought about the perforated baskets filled with objects that Tony Marsh makes. And I thought about those pieces as a kind of permission to think of these objects as art objects. So printing slip. I'm not going to give you my recipe because it's problematic, not because I'm trying to hide it from you. But I can tell you some stuff about what I've learned, and some of this might carry over to people working with Delta robots. I don't have one, so I don't really know, but I'd love if someone does some tests with this, let me know. So first of all, keep it simple, and just the basic awareness is that delayed drying time means slower printing. So that's why these mixtures have less clay in them, so that they dry more quickly. So one way to do that would be to use solvents instead of water, like acetone or alcohol. I don't want to do that in my studio, so I'm just using water. I found that 30% water is kind of the maximum that I use. It's not the maximum that could be in there, but that's the maximum that I use. And I'd like to use a little less. Then I thicken it to taste, almost like a milkshake, with magnesium sulfate, and much less water. Much less water for other styles of printers. Like if you were feeding this into the cartridge on those Delta printers, there might be an opportunity for it there. I don't know, but you wouldn't need as much water, obviously. 15% clay maximum. So I'd like to use less, but there's something that happens where the slip becomes dilatant when there's less clay than that. And so, and what happens is that the pump is squeezing this little rubber tube. So when the slip is like has pressure on it, it becomes solid. It becomes solid inside the pump, with less clay than that. So I found that that's close to the threshold with how much clay that I'd need for it to feed through this apparatus. It's just like when you go to the beach and you're walking on that kind of threshold between the water, when you step on the wet sand and it's hard and the water kind of creeps off to the side, or it's like cornstarch in water, right? So clays that work well in casting slips tend to be good in printing slips. I'm interested in drying, so I limit clays that contain significant amounts of montmorillonite because they suck up water and that increases the drying and stuff. So these are things that we call lots of ball clays, and stoneware clays would have some in it too. EPK has a lot in it. So things that have good reputation in casting slips for wicking water well, they work well in this. The slip is mostly filler. Malachite is really great. I prefer the 120 mesh. Finer mesh requires more water, and anything more coarse can be difficult to pump. Mokoa, I think it's in Ohio, Mokoa makes a 200 mesh grog, and I've begun to experiment with that. It seems nice. I got it from Laguna. And it's kind of the finest grog that I've found on the market. If anyone knows anything out about 200 mesh or 120 mesh grogs, let me know. So these kind of slips have very poor green strength because there's almost no clay in them. So a small addition of fibers can help. Toilet paper works really well, but again, I found that the TP actually like slows the drying time. So I use a really small amount. I use 10 grams of toilet paper in an 18,000 gram batch, and it does make a difference with the green strength. Dispersants like Darvan 7 or sodium silicate, they seem to be great, but they act on surface area, and since I'm using mostly non-plastic particles, there's tons of surface area. It's all mixed charge surface area, so it takes a lot of it. It has an effect. It ends up slowing down the drying time again, so I stay away from that. So these are time lapses of the objects that I have here at Tactic. And this is about 8 hours. Yeah, I do. It's always kind of different. This is a slip. This slip right here is, I think it's 2/3 200 mesh malachite and 1/3 Lysella, and then it's screened really well. So it comes out being like a stoneware at cone 10, and it's still a little porous at cone 10, because that malachite just really doesn't really want to change. How much weight? The time, or? Oh, it's really light. Okay. Yeah. So it's kind of open. So I'm playing with these forms that have air holes in them. And then also it's interesting with if you have a baskety kind of thing where there's a hole, if a crack starts, it'll stop there, right? It'll hit the hole and stop. We must be getting close on time. But here's, okay, this is the last time lapse that I have. And this is just this, real similar to the other one. You see the balloons in the background?
Yeah.
There's a motion sensor on my light. So I put a fan on a balloon so that it would stay on for the time lapse. I think that's a good illustration of these digital tools are really great, and I'm learning how to use them in my own practice, and I really love it, but I'm not forgetting what I already know how to do. Like these little wedges to level this bed, I'm not sweating, because I learned that because I was pouring lithophanes and on plaster in the lab, and I wanted my slab level. I'm going to run some code on this one. I need to get this back to we're back at zero. I need to make sure there's slip in it. I'll start that code, and then we'll, if you guys want to ask questions, we're coming to the end of it. It's a peristaltic pump, which means that it squeezes a rubber tube iteratively. There's like 8 little actuators that squeeze it down the rubber tube, and that just draws the slip out. Does that clarify? I built my own based on one that I found online, and oh, cool. Yeah, I'd love that. I'd love even like a cordless drill with a hand pump, just putting it out. I'm gonna send the wall file, and this is gonna be a real slow file that I run for the rest of the day and build some walls. I'll try to get a tighter build running tomorrow. This isn't really the best illustration, but it's still kind of fun. Yeah, it's like that. I would definitely give away the housing for that Tiny G. If someone wanted to play with that Tiny G, like there are some components and stuff, and maybe I can make a part list and the files for that. And I'd be happy to give like a Rhino file that has the DXFs for all the plates.
Yeah, that's great.
So the plates are, I didn't design these, but I did alter the plates. They're based off the second version of the Shapoko, and I had them water jet cut at a local place in New York. No, sometimes if I catch it fast enough, I'll just put some clay in there,
okay,
just fill the gap. That's it. Yeah, you smash the one that's there and then make another one. Sure. That's why these cups are really great, because if it runs out, I just have some short cups.
Okay.
You know. No, I mean, I could kind of hack my way through it. This is that's what I'm doing. I'm just kind of, but I have a reservoir at the studio that I work in normally. I have a larger PVC reservoir that'll run for a full 8 hours.
Okay.
I'm just traveling with this little thing. Cool. Thanks, guys.